Okay, what's going on, YouTube? This is your boy Mike from PNG News Media. I'm here with my guy, Muhammad Anwar, of the Muhammad Anwar Project. We're going to chop it up, do some good gang history, and talk about gang prevention. So I check the homie out.
You have a prepaid call from an inmate at California. This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded. To accept this call, say or dial 5 now. Thank you for you.
Good morning, brother.
Hey, how you doing, brother?
Oh, I'm good, brother. How about yourself?
I'm doing all right, man. I want to talk about the vicious cycle and how it affects our youngsters these days, you know, and how our youngsters are susceptible to the violence and prone to the institutions and now the families are torn apart and our fathers we grew up in knowing nothing but incarceration and violence and gangs and things that tear us apart, tears our families' values apart. You know, the gangs, they first start out to try and tear us down. They find us at a vulnerable stage and they tear us down. They tear down our family values so that we have nothing to look forward to except for them as family, you know. And it sucks, you know, because we're not even given half a chance, you know what I mean? So that's what I want to talk about today, you know.
What's your nationality?
I'm Mexican and Irish. I've grown up in with Mexican. I've grown up as a Norteño, and this is something I used to live by. I used to live by my I'll say a poem real quick, you know, and maybe I don't want to sound too explicit or anything, you know, but this is what I used to live by, you know. I used to live by when I die, bury me deep, put my stations on my feet, put a red rag on my head, put a note till I'm dead. Write my name upon the wall, tell them that I love them all, right? Tell my girl, please don't weep, we share the love so strong and deep. Tell my mom, please don't cry, wipe the tears from her eyes. Bury me down where the river flows, on my chest there's a red rose. And I was taught that poem when I was functioning, you know what I mean? I was taught that there's nothing more than anything to struggle for with your cause, you know what I mean? And my cause was being a Norteño, I still consider myself as a Norteño because I'm from the northern part of California, I go by heritage. My heritage is from down north, up north, you have people with heritage from down.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
They ID themselves as Norteños, and then you, when you go to prison, it changes. You go to MA, and you go to NF, and you go to the structure, or you go to the Southern United Raza, and that's where the vicious cycle begins. You know, it begins at a vulnerable stage in our life when we're taught at a young age not to function with anybody else but your kind. You know, and I don't want to put too much out there, but I think I put out enough. But it's all propaganda, and it's all something that affects your heritage at first, and then it becomes part of a branching out stage, and it becomes effective. Like our fathers go to prison, they get killed in prison, or they come out of prison, they sell dope, and their youngsters are left to fend for themselves. The mothers are out there on the horse throw, and they don't know anything else but being in bars, and they can't establish a stable foundation for us to grow up in. So we look forward to our friends as our family, and that's what being a true Norteño is all about. You know, being in the street gang, and then it's through heritage. So it's through the vicious cycle that we fall into, you know. And then other people get curious about it, and they want to be part of it. And on the outsiders part. And it's just a vicious cycle of it just repeats itself and repeats itself again and again, you know. And it's difficult for us to even realize what we're doing until it's too late, you know. Because we're vulnerable to the constitutions that we live by, you know, the bylaws and the constitutions that we live by. It's but that's all I wanted to say today, you know. I just wanted to put it out there that you know, we could strive for something else nowadays. We could strive for a betterment for ourselves and for our families, and get an education while we're in here in prison, or while we're in YA or Youth Authority or the Boys Ranch or whatever. We could strive for a betterment to strive for something new, you know, strive for something that's going to be a betterment for our future, you know, because there's no future in here in the pens. Behind the walls is critical. Behind the walls, and every step we make is a calculated step. And no one cares. No one cares about how we feel, how we function, how we act. All we get is three meals a day and a cut, and hopefully we get a good salary that we don't have to kill or fight with or program with, or you know what I mean? And I don't know, I wanted to put some of this out there today because it's been on my mind, you know? And if any of you listeners out there know anything about the vicious cycle, it's all part of, you know, what we really believe in, you know? I guess I'm going to stop there.
What's your experience in CYA?
Excuse me?
What's your experience in the Youth Authority?
Oh, in YA and the Youth Authority, I was in Nathaniel, and I was a soldier in YA. I was taught how to fight, how to gang bang, how to hate people, how to hate people from different sides of the street. I was taught that we couldn't talk to the opposition, the threats, the counselors there. That we had, the only ones we had is our own people, and it was mandatory. We functioned. If we didn't know how to fight, we were going to learn how to fight. If we didn't know how to stab a person, we were going to learn how to stab a person and hurt them. My experience in YA was not education. That was far from what we believed in, you know. The education was not there. It was not there at all. It was crazy there. I was impressed from 87 to 91, and I should have only been there for 6 months, but I caught up.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
And I was prepped up in there to go to prison, you know, and why it was a bunch of head games. It was a bunch of things that manipulation, propaganda, and then when I got to prison, it was more manipulation, more propaganda, more hatred, more of the head games were played in prison. You know, you had your enemies working with your enemies, and they were saying that if they couldn't be control of you, then they would have their enemies kill you, and they would work together to do it. And YA was, we worked together for a betterment, and there was a big old stepping stone there. We got manipulated to be part of something that wasn't worthy of being even called a structure. You know what I mean?
Why did Nathaniels wear red?
Well, it started from IDing people in prison. It started in prison. It was an ID card, basically. The Sereños had blue, the AMA had blue, and the Nuestra Familia had red. And when the war broke out between them, it got passed down to the youngsters as being Norteños. The NF originated in the northern part of California, and the northern part of California the youngsters were considered Norteños through heritage, so their ID cards were red, as they were a red rag. And that was the ID, a Norteño opposed to a Sereño. It was to recognize who they were, you know. It wasn't over a color. It was over heritage. It was over history. You know what I mean? It was a history card, basically, you know. They say the NF got started over a pair of shoes, but it really got started over the AMA trying to suppress the de nuestra familia, and they were going and they were pressuring people from Northern California, and they were the ones that couldn't get pressured. They were pulling them into the MA, and they were giving them an ID card, the blue rag, and an ID card to walk, you know, to ID who was who, you know, to separate the good from the bad, you know what I mean? And the NF also had people from down south that were NF, you know, and Maravilla didn't function with the MA, and so they were given red rags and to ID themselves from the. So it was basically, there's a lot of history behind it, but I don't want to get too far off into it, you know. But I think I said enough on that issue, you know.
Why does Nathaniels don't get along with the Sereños?
Well, it's not that they don't get along, it's because they're taught to hate each other. They're taught from their elders to hate each other so that they can keep the war going, you know. So that they can keep the MA and the NFs fighting amongst each other, you know. Nowadays the war's called off, you know. The war's called off, but like the Norteños have their beliefs and the Sereños have their beliefs. There's so much blood that's been drawn that now the NF and the MA get along, and they left this, you know, Norteños and the Sereños left. They left them for dead, you know. They left them to fight each other and to destroy each other, and they basically hate each other, hate everything they stand for. But the MA and the NF started it, and now they want to call off the war, and they don't care who's hurt or killed over it. You know what I mean? They're basically targets in which they don't understand. They think it's Crips and Bloods that they stand by, or that they function by a red rag and a blue rag, but it's history behind it that signifies their identity, you know?
What is the end result in joining these groups?
What's that?
What's the end result in joining these groups?
It's to gain respect, social status of equality, and to struggle with people that have the same beliefs with them as them, and to establish a family amongst themselves to function with, and to live with, and to be in harmony with, and to love, and to have that love for, you know, that they weren't getting in their houses, in their homes, you know, if they even had homes, you know, like a mother and father, and a sister and brother, and I tell you, the vicious cycle is something else, you know. I mean, it tears us up from our beliefs, it tears us up at a vulnerable stage. I started when I was 16 years old. Actually, I started when I was 12.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
When I was 16, I went to the youth authority, and after that, when I went up to the youth authority, it was all true gangbanging, you know, and it was hectic. I think it's gonna hang up, so I'm gonna get in there. So.